Peter, you and I are probably similar in that the traditional philosophical mind-body problem has occupied a lot of our mental lives from very early ages and follow the philosophy. I went into neuroscience because I wanted to try to understand that better. You've taken it a lot further than I have. So tell me what your work in neuroscience has impacted your feeling about the fundamental mind-body problem.
Okay, so what's the mind-body problem? I think there's actually several problems. One problem is, is mental causation. How can a mental event cause a physical event when the mental event is realized in the physical event? It seems,
it's circular.
It's like picking yourself up by your bootstraps. So mental causation is one of the problems. Another problem, is what is the neural code? And, what is information and how is it realized in that neural code? Another problem is what is consciousness and how is it realized in physical neuronal activity? And these things are related, but they're slightly different.
And this concept of qualia, the feeling of a red rose or the smell of garlic, what that feels like inside.
That's right. And how can something, it almost seems illogical, right? So, if you go back to Leibniz, he said, if two things that are identical have the same properties. If they have different properties, they're not identical. Okay, so here you have mental events, which are non-physical. They don't seem to have mass or and then you have
no location.
The brain, which has locations, it has masses. How can two things which are identical seem to have different properties? And so there are some real puzzles here, and I think the way to attack it is to focus not on the mind body problem in general, but on mental causation, or the neural code, or the neural basis of consciousness and qualia, and try to attack it from different angles.
Start with mental causation.
Mental causation is it's a deep puzzle. The first thing to do is talk about causation. So if you look at history, people have thought about causation in lots of different ways. But I think in the West, since at least the time of Newton, we've thought about causation as energy transfer, particles hitting each other, passing on their energy. Then there was sort of a new development in our conception of causation with the development of chemistry, where people didn't think about it simply as the transfer of energy, but also the transformation of energy, where you had, for example, hydrogen and oxygen come together, poof, you get water, and it's a transformation. It has different properties than either hydrogen or oxygen. And then the kind of mental causation, though, that I think is operative in the brain is a third kind of physical mechanism. It's not energy transfer. It's not simply transformation of energy. It's the setting of criteria on inputs that will make a neuron fire. Now, the whole brain from top to bottom is set up as a coincidence detection machine. It, from a single channel level, like an NMDA receptor will only open up if glutamate is bound to it, and glycine is bound to it, and if the...
Now that is at the synaptic level.
That's at the channel level. So, a channel is a little... Think of it like a little donut sitting in the membrane of a little... the donut is sitting in the membrane of the postsynaptic neuron in this case. And if certain facts are true, the ion channel opens and ions flow in.
Right. And that causes electrical activity.
That causes changes in what's called the potential.
Right.
So think of it, it's like voltage. It's the differential in charge across a membrane. That changes potential. Now, the language of the brain at the neuronal level is in terms of potential, assessments of potential. And if potential passes a certain threshold at the axon hillock, at the very base of the axon, the neuron will fire. Okay, so that's a very different form of causation than either energy transfer or transformation of energy. Here, neurons are not responding to the amount of input. They're responding to the pattern in their input. And that's this beautiful mechanism that evolution stumbled upon, namely coincidence detection, is what allows energy patterns to have causal effects. So, certain philosophers have said, how can patterns in energy have any causal effect? And they've given, for example, the example of a hurricane. As a hurricane seems to you know, a hurricane later in the afternoon might have completely different constituent particles in it than in the morning. But the pattern itself seems to have a life of its own, and it passes through the particles. But the reductionist argument against that has been, well, all the causal work is being done by the particles hitting each other. And so I think that the philosopher's argument that patterns can be causal has failed to answer the reductionist's criticism that it's just particles hitting particles, mm-hmm. because they don't have a mechanism in place that can say whereby patterns are converted into a physical act. Neurons respond to patterns, and the key pattern that they respond to is simultaneity of their inputs. So you can take, here's a good example. There's a kind of cell in V1 back here in the occipital lobe.
The visual area.
In the visual area.
Primary.
And a simple cell responds to, say, a bar of light. Now, this cell will take its inputs from, you know, let's say five cells coming in out of the thalamus. And those cells are each responding to a dot. Those are our dot detectors. And so the simple cell will take inputs from five of these thalamic cells, each of which is a dot detector. And let's say if three of the five arrive at the same time, so these three, or those three, or those three, then the cell will fire and it will respond to there being a bar in the world. And this is an example of criterial causation, because there is a set of criteria, namely you have to have inputs from, you know, something along this line, and it can be met in multiple ways, and if it's met, the cell will fire, and the cell will then physically alter the system, right? So here you have the conversion of pattern through the mechanism of coincidence detection, spatial pattern to temporal coincidence, and temporal coincidence being a mechanism whereby patterns, not just amounts of energy, but patterns of an energy are converted into a causally effective physical outcome.
So these patterns are the criteria that induce the causation.
Right, criteria are placed upon patterns of input. And I think a key thing that has, well, in a way, what has held neuroscience back has been a bias to think that mental causation is realized in neuronal causation, which is itself only action potentials triggering action potentials. So neurons fire, they send, you know, electrical signals down their axons, which then will trigger other neurons to fire. But I think that's only half the story. I mean, I'm not saying that's wrong, that's correct. But a key insight from recent work, and not my work, but work in theoretical neuroscience, is that neurons not only trigger each other to fire, they reset each other's criteria for firing. Mm. So this gives a solution to the mental causation problem, because, you know, the fundamental argument against both mental causation and free will historically has been, well, you can't pick yourself up by your bootstraps. How can a mental act now change its own physical basis now?
It just caused it in the first place.
You can't cause yourself, right? If the mental event or informational event is realized in a physical event, how can that go in and change its own basis? It's like picking yourself up by your bootstraps. You can't pick yourself up by your bootstraps. What you can do is hang a pulley on the wall, string your belt through it, and then pull yourself up. And in a way, the brain is doing something like that, I think, in that the a neuron firing may not trigger the next neuron to fire, but it might reset its criteria for firing. It changes that neuron's synaptic weights, and that neuron will now fire to something differently in the future.
So by making the distinction between present and future in mental causation, how does that flow back and help solve the traditional mind-body problem?
It allows you to get around the circular causation argument against both free will and mental causation, because now mental events are not changing their own physical basis now, they're changing the physical basis for potential mental events in the future. And so let's say, you know, that I give you some criteria, and I say, think of somebody who has white hair. Now, nobody knows exactly how this works, but, you know, you get that command in your working memory, and then you can set some criteria, which then can be met in multiple different ways. Then simply noise in the system allows those criteria, somebody who has white hair, to be met in multiple ways. So somebody with white hair might, you know, I don't know, Bill Clinton might come to mind, or somebody else, Nelson Mandela, might come to mind, who has white hair. And if I were to rewind the system, you might think of somebody different the next time. So, you know, the two demons torturing philosophy have been, well, determinism doesn't give you any kind of free will because it doesn't give you a strong free will because things could not have turned out otherwise. So the evolution of criterial causation, where neurons not only trigger each other to fire, but change the criteria whereby future neurons will fire, affords a physical mechanism that allows for mental events realized now to trigger mental events that will be realized in the future should their inputs be met. So the criteria, the inputs meet the criteria of the postsynaptic neuron. So this relates to this is a partial solution of a mind-body problem in the sense that it offers a physical mechanism that doesn't require any special weird forces or any quantum level weird effects. Where mental causation can occur without succumbing to this circular causation argument.